first time they've been in a church on Sunday for many years.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to the Old West Church. For anybody who doesn't know, I'm Mary Elder Jacobson, and this is Words Out Loud. This is our third Sunday afternoon reading series for this year. It's our final reading for this fall. And we have been so happy to have our other readers, Jane Shore, Howard Norman, Allison Prine, and James Cruz. And today we're incredibly honored to have two accomplished individuals on many levels, Greg Delanty and Madeleine Kunin. And in a minute, Greg and Madeleine are going to read, and they're going to read in alphabetical order. And I want to thank the curators of Art at the Kent, Del Emlyn, Allison Evans, and David Sheets for their support, and all the volunteers really at the Kent and at the Old West Church for everything that goes into making these two spaces alive and productive. And I particularly want to thank Allison Evans, who's been my co-curator this year for Words Out Loud. She's right there. And a thank you to Rick Agron, who's here with Radio Bon Mot, his radio show on WGDR. He's recording the audio of all three of the readings, and he's going to end up having those online. And we'll try to put that on the Kent site to let people know when that's up and you can listen. And also today we have Orca Media filming this reading. And we're grateful to Bear Pond Books, who made books available for sale at the Kent. And we have a really special announcement that Greg Delanty's very new book, Selected Delanty, which is really due out about October 27th in hardback, Bear Pond was able to get it from his publisher, Undive Limited, yesterday. So we have that at the Kent, and it's a beautiful book.
And it's only $19. Cheap.
A bargain. It's only $19.
A bargain.
And this is our beautiful Z-fold program designed by Linda Maravilli of Ravenmark, and it has a little bio of each of the authors. It would be impossible to put all of the prizes and honors and accomplishments of Greg and Madeleine on a little program. So I've said it before, and I'll probably say it again. To me, this building that we're in, the Old West Church, is like a poem. It has shape and form and repetition. It has good lines. It makes room for different perspectives and different emotions over time. It was built to serve many different people with box pews that encourage interconnection and sharing, and each box offering a different perspective within the same space. Like the Old West Church, which looks one way on the front, but another way on the back, the best poems provide more than one way of looking at everything. They encourage the reader or listener to interact on different levels and to be in touch with our human nature in response to personal, familial, interpersonal, and environmental matters. Greg Delanty is a creator of this type of poetry. Through both his writing and his dedication to environmental activism, he sheds light on our multidimensional, round, not flat, Earth, showing us up close the issues we must make time to pay attention to. From the nature around us, to the climate crisis we are within, to the climate within each and every one of us, to the full range of our human emotions. Please welcome multidimensional, forward-thinking, and far-reaching poet, Greg Delanty.
I got a loan of a phone here to watch the time. As it happens, I'm going to start with sort of a religious poem, or setting. I'm a non-believer myself, though I remain kind of open. but not categorized. As I said, I joked, it is the first time I have been in a church on Sunday for a very long time. But I'm glad to be here, and thank you for inviting me. When I was growing up in Ireland, it was a marked sin to enter a Protestant church. That didn't mean we didn't enter them. We snuck in as little boys, you know what I mean? It's terrible, stupid, ridiculous. Do you understand me? But if I was back now when I was growing up, I'd be committing a mortal sin. Stupid. But anyway, isn't that extraordinary? And we would be scared inside, we'd sneak in and we'd be scared. The first story set in Burlington, it's from a book called The Greek Anthology, book 17, and it's supposed to be translations, but it's not, they're all my own poems. And it's pretending, it's book 17, there's 16 books in the original one. And this, they're all made up characters. I'm just going to pretend for the moment, so that I don't have to explain too much, that they're all, well, they are all men, and I'm not going to name the names. The first story, short one really. The email, telling a friend, we're not too bad considering the state of the world, crosses the Atlantic with the touch of a key. The leaves of an evergreen blow like a shoal of emerald fish returning to the same place. A cardinal in his scarlet robe pecks the feather. The bells of the Angelus ring from St. Joseph's. The angel of the Lord declares unto Mary, the infant God of my childhood is back on earth again. The one I've ceased to believe in. The lifeblood that keeps believers afloat. In the storm of being here, issuing tickets to the hereafter. Ever since that garden episode, the tall tale of our banishment, concocted by some storyteller who'd be so flummoxed we've taken it for gospel, would say, look around you now, behold the garden. And I'm kind of going to go back to early poems now and then come back full circle. Excuse me. And to a poem I wrote after my father died, very in my early 20s. And I'm going to go through, the book is chronological, you know? So I just read bits and pieces from it. They're all short poems. Interrogative, again, a very 6 or 8 line poem. Even the flimsiest, most vulnerable creatures are equipped with devices to outwit death. The night moth blends into its surroundings. Lichen-colored, it conceals itself on bark. Other creatures don the colors of a wasp, fooling predators into believing they can sting. But how could your father outwit death's grasp, snatched forever and too soon, under its dark wing, always out in the open, without sting or cunning? I was only in my 20s when I wrote that. I'm nearly my father's age now, he died. Strange. I'm going to read it for my mother now. You might as well get all sides in case a bolt of lightning hits me from heaven. my mother, I had jobs, you know, the way one has always jobs as a child in the house. One of my jobs was to thread the eye of the needle for my mother. Because they were all a bit blind, you know, and my father and my brother. They had great eyes. So that was my job. And so there's a poem in this. There's a term in it, Amadon. Amadon means don't surf, not good at school. And I wasn't good at school. I mean, I don't mean good in the moral sense. I mean, I was slow. they thought I was so. I mean, I couldn't spell. You understand? And that time, I had dyslexia, but that time we were just lazy. Anyway, I don't need to go into this. Can you hear me okay? Is that okay, Madeleine? Can you hear me?
A little louder.
Maybe I should.
That's just for recording.
Oh, right. I thought this was on loudspeaker. Excuse me.
These are stage voice.
Okay. I thought I always use my stage voice. To my mother, Eileen. I'm threading the eye of the needle for you again. That is my specially appointed task, my gift that you gave me. Ma, watch me slip this camel of words through. Yes, rich we are still, even if your needlework has long since gone with the rag and bone man, and Da never came home one day, or Dan. Work, lose yourself in work, that's what he'd say. Okay. Ma, listen. I can hear the sticks of our fire spit like corn turning into popcorn with the brown insides of rotten teeth. We sit in our old Sleevmish house. Norman is just born. He's in the pen. I raise the needle to the light and lick the thread to stiffen the limp words. I peer through the eye, focus, put everything out of my head. I shut my right eye and thread. I'm important now, a likely lad instead of the Omadone at dread school. I have the eye, haven't I? The knack? I'm Prince Threader. I missed it, that's right. Concentrate. Enough yakety yak. There, man, look. Here's the threaded needle back. Can you hear me now? I'm exhausted out there. I feel like Orson Welles and Star to Moby Dick. Which was actually done in Cork, by the way. There was that speech, that marvellous speech. It was actually set in Youghal, which is spelled Y-O-U-G-H-A-L, just in case. Never tried to go there. A political poem, an overtly political poem. This was a description originally I got. It turned out that actually the description was, I didn't know this, but by Charles Simic. I overheard, I came into a conversation on the public radio, and I heard him describing, it was during the bombing of Belgrade, many years ago now, well, it seems like many years ago anyway, and he was describing how he was talking to his family. Charles Simic, the poet, is from Belgrade, and he was describing how they were describing what was happening on the phone. Do you understand? And then I got a poem out of it. As it happened, I found out later, and he saw it, he got a kick out of it. Yeah, that's a good poem, he says. And I said, sure, it's a good poem. International call. A hand holds a receiver out a top-story window in a darkening city. The phone is the black, old heavy type. From outside, what can we make of such an event? The hand, which seems to be a woman's, holds the phone away from her lover, refusing to let him answer his high-powered business call. More likely, a mother has got one more sky-high phone bill, and in a tantrum warns her phone-happy son she'll toss the contraption. A demented widow, having cracked the number to the afterlife, holds the receiver out for the ghost of her lately deceased husband. He's wary of heaven and wants to hear dusk birds, particularly the excited choir of city starlings. It's always dusk now, but the receiver isn't held out to listen to the birds of the earth from heaven. It's the black ear and mouth in the hand of a woman as she asks her emigrated sisters and brothers in a distant country if they can hear the strafing. And those muffled thuds, how the last thud made nothing of the hospital where they were slapped into life. The hand withdraws, the window bangs closed, the city is shut out. Inside now, the replaced phone represses a moan. Its heir to the cradle listens for something approaching from far off. This is a kind of a popular poem in the sense that it gets anthologized a lot, and Garrison Keillor read it in all of those programs and so forth, Billy. But it's the first poem from a book that I wrote, poems to a child before he was born and after, and his mother, of course. Do you understand? And so this is an early one, The Alien. All the terms are correct and so forth. Just want to be conscious of the time. We have 15 more minutes. Will you manage it? I'll try and go under so that I feel virtuous. I never feel virtuous. I'm back again. Oh, sorry. The alien, I'm looking at the ultrasound, you know, I was reading the last poem with the phone. Of course, they were in the days when nobody had mobile phones. Not so long ago, really. It's extraordinary. But anyway, the alien, looking at the ultrasound. I'm back again, scrutinizing the Milky Way of your ultrasound, scanning the dark matter, the nothingness, that now the heads say is chock-a-block with squawks and quarks, gravitons and gravitini, photons and fortinos. Or sprout, who art there inside the spacecraft of your ma. The time capsule of this printout, hurling and whirling towards us, it's all daft on this earth. Or alien, who art in the heavens, or Martian, or little green man, we're anxious to make contact, to ask divers questions about the heavendom you hail from, to discuss the whole shebang of the beginning and end, the pre-Big Bang on time, before you forget the why and lie of thy first place. And our friend, to say welcome, that we mean no harm, we die for you even, that we pray you're not here to subdue us, that we put away our ray guns, missiles, attitude, and share our world with you, little big head, if only you stay. Short elegy to his mother, my ex-wife. The present. It's 8 lines, 7 lines. 8. I won't lie in the church. Sparrows mostly. But chickadees, cardinals, blue jays, wild canaries, feed all day on our birdhouse stairs, sunflower seeds, beautiful black tears your father gave us only a year ago. He is dead now. How were we to know? Snow is a white sheet laid silently upon the body of the earth. How the dead live on. I was dreading this was going to happen, actually. See, I haven't read from this book before. I just got it myself, right? But I just noticed the typo in the middle of that poem. It says, beautiful black tears. Beautiful black tears. For, there's a, I'm sorry to put about proofing. There's a proofing demon that turns up in the middle of the night after you do the proofs again and again and again, and he goes around and changes them, you know what I mean? Loose Strife, 122. Another political poem. You know what Loose Strife is, don't you? This is a, was called, this was in the Atlantic, and it was called an American sonnet. And I can never understand why it was an American sonnet, except that perhaps the only thing that makes it a sonnet as an American sonnet was that it is 14 lines, but there's nothing else. It's no rhyme, no nothing. Do you know what I mean? You have become your name, the Loose Strife. Carried on sheep, spurting up out of ballast, a cure brought across the deep to treat wounds, soothe trouble. There have been others like you, the rhododendron, the cattails that you in your turn overrun. Voices praise your magenta spread, your ability to propagate by seed, by stem, by root, and how you adjust to light, to soil, spreading your glory across the earth, even as you kill by boat, by air, by land, all before you, the hardy iris, the rare orchids, the spawning ground of fish. You'll overtake the earth and destroy even yourself. Ah, or Loose Strife, purple plague, beautiful us. I was also kind of putting on the US there as well, but I shouldn't say those things, should I? You knew that already. This is a poem from our, there are translations in this book as well. And I am an activist, and I actually, in my life, I don't have a car. I gave up the car. So we had to get a loan of a car to get here today. Big treat to go driving in the countryside. But, except we got lost, but anyway, that's another story. And I cycle everywhere during the winter to say my school and stuff. And the house is fossil fuel. There's no fossil fuels. I'm off oil and gas. So you can do it. If I can do it, you can do it. Well, you probably are doing it, but it's important to me. And I don't, you know, I've started, I keep doing activist things and so forth. I got arrested with Bill McKibben outside the White House there those years ago against the tar. In those almost halcyon days. Excuse me. This is written by Sean O'Reardon, but it's in Gaelic, so I'll just read the translation. And there's a name mentioned here. He was from Cork, and fabulous poet, but he was the first poet really who brought modernism into the Irish language. And there's a term here, Glomnagalt, is just the Valley of the Mad, which is an actual valley in Kerry. I have a house now in Kerry too, but which is where they sent mad people, you know what I mean, people who they said were mad, which is going, can be different. Apathy is out. There's not a fly, moth, bee, man or woman created by God, whose welfare's not our responsibility. To ignore their predicament isn't on. There's not a madman in Glomnagalt we shouldn't sit with and keep company, since he's sick in the head on our behalf. There's not a place, stream, or bush, however remote, or a flagstone, north, south, east, or west, that we shouldn't consider with affection and empathy. No matter how far South Africa, no matter how distant the moon, they're part of us by right. There's not a single spot anywhere we're not a part of. We issue from everywhere. I'm going to go into the more recent poems and then leave you. Five moments. I'm just trying to judge it. Excuse me. I might be only 10 seconds under. Travel's Quest 2:15. Sorry, talking to myself. The Traveller's Grace. This is by Gregorius Plenipennius. I won't go into it, but they're all puns of my own name, or else friends or people I like. Like there's one to Galway here. You know that Madeleine was very friendly with Galway. And there's one for David Budbill also. Lois is here. But anyway, I don't know, will I get a chance to read them? The Traveller's Grace. Nothing like landing in a foreign city early morning, preferably on weekday hubbub. Everyone going about their business, lost in themselves. Not a thought of how strange, foreign, alien their lives are. How abnormal to think it normal to find ourselves on a spinning ball reeling around a star at thousands of miles per hour from who knows where to who knows where. How outlandish. I am one of the sacred dead, released from the underworld of the mundane, the banal. Behold the normal. I'll read the winner, one written, Dave, Greek anthology names, Panos Canellius. Do you understand? But it was just a way of acknowledging Galway and David and everybody. But the winners, 6-line poem, 5 lines. The blue bottle reigns supreme now over the kingdom of a carcass. It doesn't matter to the fly if it's a cow, rat, salmon, human, or ass. The blue bottle is a glimmering gem, not on death's, but on life's diadem. I had a great friend, some of you might have known him, Ed Epstein, who died of Alzheimer's. So there's a short poem on that, towards the end, these are some. Excuse me, I'm not used to this book yet. The great thing is that I don't have to rifle through different books. Elegy to a friend with Alzheimer's. Your memory was dispatched ahead of you to the land of Orcus. The spool of all you are to yourself, erased, though not to us. This is as good as addressing the dead. Your body's a bloodhound baying, the scent lost at that last river. Dumb but tell Menesmini, or the boss of Lethe, or whatever god your final host, that my heart's a clenched fist. You are a man alive, dearly missed. And then I'm just going to finish up with two short poems. Umbilical. It makes a reference to the Irenes, or the Furies at the end, which were also called the Ever So Kind, sarcastically. Here we go. Umbilical, it's a sonnet, an actual sonnet. You bike most everywhere. This is myself, of course. Umbilical. You bike most everywhere these days, weary of your part in the latest war, the slaughter of innocents, the various wily ways you've grown used to, complicity's feather. The gas pump is an umbilical cord sucking the life out of exhausted terra mater. You read about leaders ready to award the future and mammon her body, smother her in her own fumes. You know the reward, the faith of those who kill their mothers. Remember Orestes? You translated to humankind, down through the arenas, the avenging daughters, driving tormenting Orestes out of his mind. No escaping the Furies now, the ever so kind. And I'm going to finish up with a kind of a hopeful poem. And of course, the leaders there, the politicians there, and I'm very glad to be reading with Madeleine, who I've always admired. And I even ran in one of the elections one time when you were canvassing with Peter Clavel, and we walked into a diamond. I ran, anyway, I won't go into it now, but. But it was very nice. No, I won't go into me running, you know what I mean? It was kind of funny, but. It's a short poem. Again. And thank you for listening. I never thought I'd be on a pulpit on a Sunday. And certainly my mother and father and all the teachers wouldn't have thought of it. Patient. The snow has melted clean off the mountain. It's winter still. Yet another indication that Gaia is in trouble, that things aren't sound. The rocky mountaintop shines like the bald head of a woman after chemo, who wills herself out of her hospital bed to take in the trees, the squirrels, the commotion around town, sip beer in a dive, smile at the child ogling her shiny head, wishing it didn't take all this dying to love life. Thank you very much.
How many of you were at the Women's March in Montpelier? I was there. I guess they're arguing about how many thousands there were, but I was there. And I was standing there with my homemade sign that I made, which I had thought long and hard about what phrase or image might speak to the many different issues for many different women. And in the end, my sign said, "Vermont, let's lift all women up." And the words were painted on a cardboard golden dome with Ceres, the goddess of agriculture, on top. Because aren't we lucky to have our symbol in Vermont be a female in the highest place at the State House? The crowd was very thick. I couldn't move an inch. It was shoulder to shoulder, sign to sign. But when Madeleine Kunin came up to speak, I found I was actually able to move forward. And then when she quoted a poem by Emily Dickinson, I was able to move forward a little more. And then months later, she read in Randolph, her hometown Randolph, and I sat at the edge of my pew, happy to hear more, transfixed, and listening to her share her work in a medium that I had not known was hers, but it is. Please welcome a Vermont woman who lifts us all up, poet Madeleine Kunin.
Thank you. Thank you so much. First, I have to express my admiration for this beautiful church and our gratitude for the people who worked hard to keep it this way. It's just an amazing legacy. I wonder if they had pillows then. But fortunately, they give them out today. You have to pay attention. You really can't fall asleep during the sermon because your backside will prompt you to stay awake. But, you know, when you introduced me as a poet, that's still new to me. And I'm delighted to be in the company of Greg Delanty, who has a whole book of poems and has earned that title over the years. And I'm happy to be included in this series. You might be surprised that a politician can become a poet. I still am. And I've written poems off and on, sporadically, very sporadically. But in the last 2 years, I would say, I've focused more on my inner life than my outer life. And you sort of need time and reflection to make that transformation. And so these are some of the results of thinking about how my life has changed. Not only that I don't shake every hand in this church campaigning, but that aging is a new phase of life. And so most of these poems are reflections on how I view that process. So the first poem is called No Longer. No longer will we make love before breakfast. No longer will I dream of seeing New Zealand or the Cape of Good Hope or bears in the wild. No longer will I say yes more than no. No longer will danger sparkle and safety look dull. No longer will I look at my body without comparison between who I was and who I have become, blaming the light for the difference. No longer can I toss my hair over my face and count 100 strokes. No longer can I do without night cream and day cream, slathering on ounce after ounce. No longer can I be comfortable sitting in my chair reading for hours without getting up to stretch my arms and legs. No longer can I walk without looking down at my feet to avoid mean cracks and malicious bumps. No longer can I skip downstairs like a girl flying without feeling a thing. No longer can I approach the precipice without swaying against my will. No longer do I think ahead of where I will be in 10 years or 20 or more. Now I think in ones or twos or threes, long enough to still hunger for the food of life. No longer do I wish for the next day or the next year to come quickly, like I did the year I turned 10. I want the days to saunter, like a leisurely museum stroller who stops now and then to gaze and get closer to the canvas, to see the brush strokes, and then steps back for the long view before moving on. This is the result of a nightmare. It's called teeth. I spit them out like olive pits, tainted yellow and hard, uprooted from the cave of my cheek, where my tongue fingers empty rooms, leaving black squares where none should be. I contort my smile to hide the hag I have become. My tongue takes measurements in and out, back and forth. A sleep-drenched sigh, my lids seek light. Ah. I am saved from death by ivory. I open wide. One tooth hangs on the edge of a cliff, another set in a tub of space where it may wobble and lose balance. I panic at the thought. I must bare my teeth in self-defense. I must chop my way into old age. I must open wide and smile. I must grit. I lift my electric toothbrush off its solid base and brush and brush and brush. This is called words. Words, my darlings, don't leave me. I reach for you in the void, white with emptiness, fingers bent, I clutch at vapor and feel nothing. I turn to the alphabet, A, B, C, D, E, F, G, like the child I was playing hide and seek, lost in the labyrinth of sense and sound. Come out, wherever you are. Ring around the rosy, we all fall down. Stop. The bell rings. Time to go home. The game is up. Wait. My ghost word jumps out from behind the tree, incised in the black trunk, raw to the vain touch of my trembling hand. This is called I Am Multiples. It's but maybe I shouldn't say anything. Just let it go. I am multiples, the dancers electric. I am multiples, the dancers elastic poses. Stretch my legs high and wide. Ere I fall on his hand as if nothing had happened. The opera singer sways by my sucking ribs. Her high octaves tremble my bones and wrinkle my throat as I spill gallons of sand all over myself. I'm on the tennis court with someone else's arm, Venus or Serena. My body obeys every quick command from head to foot. Look, just inside the line by half an inch, the camera ascends. My sizzling serve that knows no return. The cello is settled between bent legs and curved arms, leaving fingers free to run up and down in pursuit of fleeing notes that I gulp down into a thick, low sound that feels good inside. I abscond with the poet's words and claim them for my own. Or were they mine in the beginning? I mouth them with tongue and teeth and spit them in your face. The writer says what I wish to say, leading me from room to room in her house, which seems eerily familiar. She lived there once. Can I call the moving van and place my bed here and the chairs over there? Canvas, stone, wood, chisel, brush, paint. Barefaced, fully awake, ready for action. Move, they say, like we did, and make a mark. I do, asking Monet, Manet, and 90-year-old Picasso to leave me a space. I am multiples, I am none. It is late, it is done. My husband just sneezed. I'd like to thank him for encouraging me to write. And some of these poems are quite personal. You did the dishes. I cooked, you did the dishes. Did I love you for that as I listened to high note clattering in the kitchen while I sat in my chair reading the newspaper? We shared most tasks then, but you did the driving, and I could sit quietly by your side with only a rare glance in the rearview mirror to check if it was safe to pass. Now, I do everything, cook and wash the pots and fill and empty the dishwasher, which always is hungry. I make the bed, which you made when we slept together. Now I straighten my back to keep my posture, not letting it sink into a stoop as I push your wheelchair up the incline. Only I can get you there and bring you back. Pushing from the back, I am in the lead, aiming to pull you out of yourself and into the world I inhabit. You visit me from time to time, and we talk about the New York Times and the Evening News Hour. And we agree the world is spinning crazily out of its orbit. We attach ourselves again in tune, bemoaning. Did I love you because you did the dishes, or because I love you? A few more lines. When I cook and clatter, I love you when I cook and clatter in our kitchen with white counters that always need wiping again and again. This is called When I Was Sick. When I was sick with stinging cramps, I could not carry my eyelids open. A morsel felt sticky in my mouth. My intestines went round and round, churning and speaking their agitated language, push and pull, back and forth, telling me how hard they had to work so that I could exist. I promised myself then that when I returned to the land of the well, I would secrete gratitude from every pore. To God, she, whoever, whatever, I would take a deep breath, deeper than everyday breath, and exhale a bellows of air that could blow your house down. I would thank God or someone very much like her to being alive today. This is caregiver blues. It's more mood than muscle that is hard to lift. From walker to wheelchair, a chasm he must reach. He cannot fall, not now, not again. Then we fell side by side. He backward landed on his rear, I forward, just missed the wheels and arms of the deadly walker. My neck hurt, my shoulder bruised. Angry with him for standing up without holding on. This time I could not reach across to grab his hand. This time I could not reach across to grab his hands, stricken by wicked gravity, falling out of control in helpless air, pushing him down into folded collapse. I am more upset than he is, or so it seems. Speechless, I want to cry. Out of frustration, out of pity for him, pity for me. This was written in June of this year. The lilacs were patient all year, packaged into themselves in small Ziploc bags that allowed them privacy in preparation for spring. They waited until ripeness attacked and felled them open, releasing their lungs and dangling their colors in intoxicated air. How did they know when it was time to spill the scent and make me breathe deeply into my chest and let it linger there? How did they know when to shrivel dry into brown kernels that keep their secrets enshrouded, emitting nothing? I've got it. This is an earlier poem. It's called Ants. I spared a spider her death in the bathtub this morning. She was doing no harm. Let her live. I get kinder as I get older, more forgiving. I step into the kitchen, black ants crawling on the counter, ants upside down on the walls. My hand sweeps them to the floor. Quickly, not thinking, I stomp on them, one by one by one. Oh, sitting next to me has purple veined hands, thick as ropes. I look at my hands, only a shade lighter, inky veins bulging out of my paper skin. How could I be almost like him? These are a couple of poems when I went canvassing for Hillary in Youngstown, Ohio, in a very poor section. Canvassing Youngstown before the election. I can't vote. I'm wearing a bracelet. I had to think a moment before I got it. The young black man with spiky gelled hair was polite. He explained, I got out of jail yesterday and could only walk from here to the store. He went further. I was in for assaulting a cop, but he assaulted me. But they don't believe me. Are you in school? I graduated from high school last June. What came over me? I wanted to save him here on his street, standing in his driveway. Stay clean and go to college, I told him, carried away by my sudden urge to set him free and become his savior. This is the same young man, Paul Diapers. I ignored his missing upper teeth when I first spoke to him. He wanted to talk. I wanted him to vote. And he assured me that he was registered and would. We walked across the street and knocked on the door of another house on our list. He appeared again. That's my house. Oh, you live here? Yes, I'm checking on my little girl. It's not easy to be a single father. We nodded, and then he asked, do you know anywhere where I could get free diapers? Have you tried welfare? They don't give them out. I thought of a sleeping baby. Did he say she was three? I ignored that she may have been too old for diapers. I saw a baby alone in her crib in dirty diapers. Wait a minute, I said. I went to her waiting car, opened my wallet, and took out 2 fives and a 10. I went back and gave him the money. He's probably going to use it to buy drugs, my friend said. I don't care, I said. I believe him. Words. Oh, I read that one. Are you old? Are you old? Am I young? No, really, no. I don't want to slide into that other place with a slit down the middle that leaves me alone in my superiority. Getting out of bed. It's hard to pull myself out of my bed by 8 like I used to do, or even 7, sometimes 6. Fatigue is the weight that presses my body down with a bolder fist. I weigh 300 pounds or more. My head turns but does not lift from its pillow, from its hollow on the squished pillow. Only 5 minutes more, I plead to the scold, and she succumbs. 9 o'clock, my God, how could that be? I'm sleeping my life away, an hour lost forever to the pull of death. Someday these will be in a book. Actually, some of these will be in the book next September, where I have a memoir and it'll be interspersed with some poems. Summer. Summer is so short. Winter is so long. I don't want to stop swimming. The lake pulls me with its lake smell, I see no boundaries, unlike the pool, where I count laps and emerge satisfied. Here I swim in large water and feel small. I see the lake in winter, its dull, hard surface, hard enough to drive a truck across and freeze a fish in place. Cold waves spitting on rocks, turning into long-toothed icicles. Can this be? Each sun splash day a miracle, unlike the biting mouth of winter. I'll make the effort. I'll swim a little longer. But my short breath and cold skin tell me it is time. This is about fall. It was written about 2 years ago. The earth is a burial ground of brown papered leaves, carelessly left to themselves. Not a sound underfoot, no sign that I was here. I see a black footprint scooped of leaves, a deer who knows something I don't know, like where it's going. Brooding oaks and storm-scarred maples ask for my sympathy. They have lost so many. I dare not stop. I must move on, trampling on their dead. This is a poem a few years ago. They were my sheets and his bed. These are not the right sheets, he said, letting the corner limp down over the edge. Just tuck them in, I said, with a hint of annoyance. That he didn't know better. They always fit on my bed, I said, exactly what I thought, knowing that I might not be understood, or worse, offend. There was a slight grating echo to our words, which we heard in different ways. In other times, with other people, it would have shredded the tie that bound us. But in this time, with the two of us, the tear was so quickly rewoven that we looked at each other and laughed. Well, how am I doing on time? Why marry? The decision was not made as one would make a box, fitting the edges carefully together, getting the sides straight. We came upon it separately and together. Or perhaps I should say it appeared, or better yet, evolved, like a growing thing that had its own destiny. No bended knee, no declarations or promises. I can't even remember if there was a kiss. There must have been, but there have been so many since that they're hard to assign to a time and place. The decision was too easy, some might say, too hasty for an old couple like us. But then we didn't have the time to weigh what we would do or the inclination we felt. We felt light-feathered, translucent, ready to soar into our own unknown. This is a love poem. Each night I wheel you to your door with a kiss on your lips. I smile my love at you, generously, I think. You don't know how much I love you, you say. Yes, I do, I do, I do. We formed a ritual of waving goodbye as I retreat down the hall, slowly at first. I wave with one hand in the air, and then my arms go wild before I turn the corner, as if struck by a storm or signaling for help. We wave in tandem. You are there, and I am here. The nurses now know we wave not for them, but for one another, to have and to hold the love we swore to. Just two more. This was written in 2014. Can there be more to say after we have said everything there is to say about oatmeal, warm toast, and sliced bananas? The weather has words. I find them in a report that I wear gloves, but no boots, not yet. He is inside and I am out where the air is colder than it was before. Chances of snow mixed with rain, one never knows which way it will come down. We have no plans that have to be changed. We talk about dinner, what time, what place, dining room or cafe. Small morsels of words fill us up until we pause, take a breath, and devour another sentence. This is, we live at Wake Robin in Sheldon, and this was New Year's Eve at Wake Robin. The wheelchair danced in circles to the rapid beat of the Onion River Jazz Band. She was young again, unbound with joy, free, no longer pushing him, but flying with him on the dance floor. He waved aside his ribboned oxygen tube, streaming behind him. I grasped John with both hands and brought him to his feet, placing the walker within reach. He moved his head and then his arms and then his feet to the music. We danced, we sang, with the walker between us and love inside us.
There's beverages and snacks. And